this would be considered a major college athletic facility. In fact, the NCAA might say that this is a premier college athletic setting. The NCAA also tells us that only one out of every 10 American high school athlete, boy or girl, will ever find their way to a college setting like this. And that is a hard reality. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, a program which attempts to address those realities. Join us, won't you, as we discuss issues and topics both informative and provocative. Good evening, everyone. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this, once again this evening, is the Inside Corner. The topic this evening is probably nine parts sociology. It has to do with the exodus of last year of nearly 15,000 teachers from Illinois high school systems, and a predicted another 15,000 teachers this coming year, 2005-2006. The topic then is the next generation of teacher and coach. Will they uphold the traditions and the value teaching and all of the protocols and policies that communities have come to understand and expect? The next generation of teachers and coaches. I have with me, in my mind, three youngsters. I know they don't appreciate that, but I do look at them as youngsters. They're so young I hardly can remember myself being that age. To my left, my immediate left, Tim Racki, graduate of Southern Illinois University, 12 years experience as a teacher and a coach. 12 of those years, that's 13 years, 12 of those years at Driscoll High School in Addison, Illinois. Presently the head football coach and dean of students at Nazareth Academy in LaGrange Park. And next to Tim is Kari Karubus, who has 8 years of experience in the English classroom, 5 years previously at Wabanzee Valley High School in Aurora, where she taught English and was the head girls gymnastics coach. And that is her capacity at Lyons Township High School as an English teacher and head gymnastics coach. And finally, one Aaron Berthold, age 28, Illinois State University graduate. In his sixth year as a teacher here at Lyons Township, he teaches business law and consumer economics. And previous to LT, he was at Regis Jesuit High School in Denver, Colorado, where he was head boys cross country coach. And that's the position he presently holds here at LT in his first year at LT as a business education teacher and head cross country coach. So you're getting an idea now of what the younger group looks like, as opposed to the gray-haired, red-eyed, red-faced remnant, ghost of teachers gone by. And I want to know from them just what they feel the expectations are upon them and what they intend to do about it. What are they prepared to do? You know, and I think parents out there watching and kids, parents in particular, of course, so much of our subject matter is geared to you, informational stuff geared to you. I think you want to know. You want to know who it is that your sons and daughters will be interacting with. Who's going to be in supervising? What's the depth of their maturity and their experience? And so I have three examples to bring you tonight, and I'll let you judge for yourself as they ask them questions like, what brought you to this profession? Was it the money? Was it all the riches and benefits and all the perks that brought you to this profession? In all seriousness, Aaron, why are you a teacher?
I love working with kids. Growing up, I was a lifeguard and taught swimming lessons and loved being outdoors and the playful atmosphere that provided. And I had actually two parents that were educators, so I saw firsthand of what that lifestyle was like. My mother was a you know, just retired actually as one of the, you know, I don't know if it's 15,000 or 1,500 teachers that just retired as a special ed teacher for 30-some years. My dad, I was a math teacher, high school math teacher, and then went into administration and just retired.
So you have like a genetic group.
Yeah, it's kind of like Dave France and, you know, it's kind of inbred there. But never really thought I was going to go into teaching. It's been a while at Illinois State trying to figure out what I wanted to do, and just really loved that interaction. Worked a couple summer jobs in college as a day camp counselor and knew that that was
so
something.
You felt it was a natural fit for you.
It's a natural feel. It's kind of a
Do you have any relatives in your family? Immediate
family?
Yeah,
very similar to Aaron.
Very similar.
My mother is a teacher. She retires this year, and my dad was a college professor.
Mm.
So
Tim?
It's natural.
No, my oldest brother is in education, but he went in after I went in. So he followed me.
You. What do you think? Do you think you two in particular, you think there's a you gravitated to teaching because you saw your parents, there was a certain happiness or a comfort on their part that you thought, hey, maybe this is what I ought to do too? Or you weren't an approval seeker, were you? You didn't do it because your parents
I think for many years I wanted to not be a teacher. You know, I just was in athletic training, exercise physiology, a bunch of different stuff, not anywhere near business education. Didn't really ever see myself really being a teacher, but it's a great lifestyle as far as, I mean, you get to work with people all day long. At 3 o'clock, especially with a coaching opportunity, you get to switch hats and be outside, be with kids, and be with them at a different level that you aren't with them sometimes in the classroom. And it's long hours, the benefits, summer vacations. I mean, we got to take summer vacations like no other. I mean, we'd spend weeks out in Colorado and Jackson Hole and up in, you know, Glacier. And
there's probably a point in time in the history of teaching where the summer vacation probably was a work-free, finally did become a work-free vacation period for teachers in America. But there was a time when it wasn't work-free. Teachers just went to another job, and there was a whole generation of teachers that did that. You keep emphasizing the outdoors as though you're claustrophobic when you're in the classroom. Is this what you want people to think about you?
And I do get claustrophobic a little bit. It's definitely it's a little easier to be inside back in the Chicago area.
Yeah.
When you have 300 some days of sunshine out in the Front Range of Colorado, it's a little bit different.
It was Denver?
It was Denver, No, but I really enjoyed being back in the classroom. I was an IT director for the last few years at Regis. So I had limited student contact, and I definitely like being back.
What's the sense of being in schools if you don't have contact with kids?
Yeah.
What's the sense? Do you perceive yourself, Tim, do you perceive yourself as a teacher or a coach? Choose one.
Oh, hands down, teacher.
You're a teacher.
Teacher. Well, you know, my dad gave me this quote a long time ago, from Lombardi. Vince Lombardi, you know, coaching is teaching. You know, that's what it is.
Yeah.
And from day one, because I've been asked that a lot, but I've always thought of myself, when I was in the classroom as a teacher, and even when I was on the football field or coaching track as a teacher.
And you followed Dennis Moran as the football coach at Nazareth. And Dennis is an icon, you know.
He's top shelf. Yeah.
He's an icon in LaGrange area, and he's a fine man and a stand-up guy. He's now the president of Nazareth Academy, correct?
Yes.
This is some position.
The reason I came here, right? he's the head coach.
Okay, so. So you have a tough act to follow.
Right.
I mean, this is a guy who made the playoffs, even though they were in the private school league at that time, which was a... Competitively, it wasn't what you're involved in now. It isn't.
Well, we used to play when I was coaching at Driscoll. Yeah. We would play Nazareth. Mm-hmm. So I would always go up against Dennis. Yeah. You know, Coach Moran, and he was
but
always.
You weren't in their configuration.
That was a non-conference game, right? Yeah. Right. So him and I, we have a history together, 10 years. So I mean, okay. I've always known what type of, you know, teacher man. You know, we became friends. So when he took the top spot at Nazareth, and we started talking, that's. The growth that's going on at Nazareth and with the principal, Debbie Vondrasik, who's a tremendous teacher as well and a leader, with those two running the show, I just thought it was a great opportunity.
You don't feel any pressure to live up to something over there? Or
you know what? I like the pressure. I mean, I like the pressure because, you know, we had some success at Driscoll where I came from.
Yeah, you won state championship.
Yeah, four, right.
Four of them.
Right.
Holy mackerel.
So
wow. Four straight. I thought it was more like two, but it was four.
Right.
Four consecutive state championships?
Yeah.
Did they win again this year and
yeah.
You weren't there?
Yeah. Yeah, my guy took over for me.
Yeah.
Was, you know, closer to age to the, yeah. I feel like the old guy here, but, and they did it again, so I was very happy for the
Tim
kid.
Tim is 38 and he's calling himself an old guy. His shoes older than this guy, you know what I'm saying? Here's the way I get it. Here's what my impression of you, because I've read the paper, newspaper articles. There's a nice article in the Tribune they had about you.
Right, yeah, it was nice.
And the reason I asked you to come by, because I know, not only did I know you're competent, but I thought if there's any teacher, new teacher, or teacher new to a setting, one or the other, who is going to feel a whole lot of duress and pressure to live up to a standard, it might be Tim Racki at Nazareth, where they're expecting him to bring the program, the football program, back to its level of accomplishment when it was in the private school league and winning. It was thrown into the mix in the East Suburban Catholic, correct?
Yes.
With schools like Joliet Catholic and Marist and Marion Catholic and who else?
Carmel.
Carmel from Mundelein. And these are schools with larger enrollments, but and also with a whole lot more wherewithal to put big teams on the field. So along comes Nazareth, a school of 750. They decide they'll enter into the East Suburban, and they hire a new football coach who's going to redeem them, you know, who's going to bring them back, who's going to bring back the glory days. And I thought so. I thought, well, I'd like to have this guy on in this mix to see, you know, he, even though he's 38 and been teaching 13 years, he's still relatively, compared to some of his mentors, he's just a kid.
Well, Dennis and I are cut from the same cloth, too. Our philosophies are a lot the same. So, you know, like we like to say, you know, I'm just hoping to take whatever I bring to the table to the next level, you know, with the football program and with, you know, the disciplinary part with the school, being
yeah.
a dean.
And being the disciplinary dean, this is a handful of work. I mean, this is a big day. Do you perceive yourself as a teacher or a coach?
Yes.
Which is it? And I know Tim mentioned the Lombardia philosophy of coaching is teaching, and definitely that's so real.
I teach like I coach, and I coach like I teach, and I think that's a very healthy relationship, especially in the gym. You know, you need to be a role model, you need to mean business, but then you get to add that personal side to it. You get to know your kids a little more.
Yeah, don't you?
Isn't you can just, and therefore, you can push them a little harder, and I do bring that to my classroom, too.
We had a panel of three kids on two shows ago, the topic being, what do you expect of your coaches? And they expected far more of their coaches than they did of the teachers. And one of the key questions was, if you had a personal problem, to whom would you take that problem outside of your counselor? Who would you take that to? And they all said they'd rather go to their coach with that personal problem than the teacher. The point was they don't feel the same emotional connection in the classroom that they do on the athletic field. So both, all of you have been describing this feeling of...
It's an investment.
Investment, and you feel much more invested and much more connected when you're dealing with your athletes than you might feel when you're in the classroom, given the realities of the classroom. So you're a teacher before you're a coach.
I can't really decipher between the two, to be honest with you. I don't think my personality is really very different.
It's just a vague.
It's not even a line.
Shady little difference, right? Not even.
I would say I smile a little more in the gym, maybe, but that would be it.
Don't you think it's much more likely some kid's liable to walk up to you from your gymnastics team and say, hey, my parents are getting divorced, I don't know what to do about this. It's much more likely to happen on the athletic field, practice time.
Yeah.
Or.
Well, I'm pushing them to a point where they're a little vulnerable, so, you know, they can be themselves in the gym and within those walls. So if they need a crutch or someone to lean on, you know, they can lean back, okay.
Yeah. That's what they reported when they were here. They said that they trust that coach much more in that regard. That's so much pressure for the coach, though. Because you're being a sociologist plus a teacher plus a coach. You're being psychologist, social worker, teacher, coach. You've got your subject matter, English or business ed, and then you've got your real subject matter,
people.
That's been like that, hasn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, was it like that?
Yeah. Yeah. What I think has changed, and you can, I think you might have some perspective on this. My experience was, as the years went by, from generation to generation of students, the needs of the kids increased tremendously. The needs of the kids, the emotional, sociological needs of the kids just increased exponentially. And that kind of coincided with the breakdown in the family unit. The more kids you got in class from single parent homes or homes with turmoil, the more it seemed you were doing social work rather than subject matter. And that was okay with me because that was so vital, so crucial. It took a lot of emotional energy, but it was. So, teacher.
I mean, in all those different aspects. Yeah. I mean, the content, the subject material. I mean, while it's important, and you have to, you know, meet certain standards. I mean, it's only maybe a third of the time. You know, you're talking about, you know, again, respect issues. I don't, you know, find it. I'm tying in as much here at LT that I did at, you know, at Regis High School. Mm-hmm. But you know, the people skills, the personal skills, the relationships. I mean, running 10 miles, you know, with a kid on a Saturday, you're spending, you know, an hour and a half with this person, you know, running and listening to, you know, having conversations with them, listening to their conversations and developing a rapport that makes the classroom that much better. Because, mm-hmm. You know, not only do they call you coach in the classroom, but other kids who know you're a coach call you coach, and because they know that you're this well-rounded person or have these, you know,
right,
passions outside the classroom.
Yeah.
You know, when you call them about a business law question or an economics question, they're more likely to be a little more open with that.
I see your point. They get to see all sides of you. And each side is more human than the last one. Definitely more human than the classroom side.
Definitely.
In the classroom, you're wearing that persona. There's that healthy distance you have to create between you and them. That distance that you can use to your advantage to manipulate the classroom, manipulate in a positive sense. It's your persona, your role in the classroom. But you don't have that. You don't do that when you're coaching. There's a closeness, there's an intimacy that you don't quite get in the classroom. But nonetheless, coaching is teaching. I don't know if there's an answer. It's an enigma. But you'll have to come back to hear it. We're going to take our usual public service announcement break. It takes 2 minutes, but we'll be right here waiting for you. Once again, this is Terry Sullivan, the Inside Corner, and we are discussing teachers and coaches, the next generation. Please come back. We'll be right here.
Would you notice if you were missing half your kidney function? According to the National Kidney Foundation, 20 million people have chronic kidney disease, and 20 million more may be at risk and not even know it. Anyone with high blood pressure, diabetes, or family history of chronic kidney disease is at risk. Early diagnosis is vitally important. To get the whole story, talk to your doctor and visit the National Kidney Foundation at kidney.org or call for a free brochure. Because when it comes to chronic kidney disease, you might not know the half of it.
Diabetes is a killer. After I was diagnosed, I didn't feel sick, so I didn't listen to my doctor. Then it struck. I had a heart attack, then a stroke, and I was only 49.
Most people with diabetes also have high blood pressure and cholesterol, which can cause severe heart damage. In fact, 2 out of 3 people with diabetes die from heart disease or stroke.
Don't let diabetes destroy your life.
Call for your free diabetes survival guide. Choose to live.
Some things just come naturally. Knowing how to buy a home isn't one of them. But today, learning how is suddenly much simpler, now that Home Loan Learning Center is here. From baby steps about your finances to getting the most home you can, it's all here and easy to understand at homeloanlearningcenter.com.
It's not uncommon for a professional golfer to hole a bunker shot for a miraculous birdie. Thank you. For the rest of us, the bogey save is no less dramatic. Log on to PlayGolfAmerica.com to discover new and easy ways to get more golf into your life.
Thank you so much for coming back. If you haven't noticed, this is Channel 99, except if you're living in certain pockets of the viewing area, it might be Channel 16. Go figure. 16 or 99, we're glad to have you back. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, and the topic this evening is teachers and coaches, the next generation. If you didn't know this, there have been massive retirements in the last 5 years in Illinois. Perhaps as many as 75 to 100,000 teachers have retired. That's grade school and high school, of course. And this next generation of teachers coming up, and I wanted you to see them. I wanted you to meet them and discern for yourself whether or not this next generation is the one that you want surrounding your children. Is this the one you want them to be associated with? Are these people of the caliber and character that you expected based on your relationship with the last generation of teachers? And I think you'll be pleasantly surprised and pleased by the three that we have here as examples, namely Tim Racki, Dean of Students and Head Football Coach at Nazareth Academy, and Kari Karubus, Masters in English Teaching in English Classroom at Lyons Township High School and Head Girls Gymnastics Coach. And next to her, one Aaron Berthold, Boys Cross Country Coach and Business Education Teacher. They're all youngsters to me, but I'm learning from them by the minute here. Do you feel that any of your athletes might sense your, and please forgive me, your relative inexperience compared to the people who left your room and used your desk at one time and were head coaches at one time? Do you think they sense your newness, at least to your settings, your relative inexperience? Do they sense that, and are they testing your methods?
I was honest about it when I first came to Nazareth about, you know, not knowing, being new with the kids and telling them that it was going to be a process. You know, I was at one place for so long, everybody knew what I was like. They didn't know what I was going to be like. They just knew, you know, maybe a little bit of my record from the old school. So that whole getting to know the team and then the individuals, the entire school was a process. But I let them know that, you know, it was going to be scary for me a little bit. It's going to be exciting. But, you know, whether they're going to accept my style, my philosophy, and how are they going to react. But I'm always very honest, especially with my teams, about how I'm feeling going into any mm-hmm. situation. So,
hey, Kari, you stepped up behind Jaron Williams-Lazier.
Yes.
I knew her as Jaron Williams, an LT graduate.
Yes, those are some big shoes for me to fill.
Who started girls gymnastics at LT.
Yes.
There wasn't anything. There was some club activity going on in those nightmarish days, prehistoric days before girls had equal rights, Title IX. But she started girls gymnastics at LT and took it to where it was when she handed it over to you.
Yes.
Did they test you, the kids who knew?
They really did, and I was welcoming of the challenge, and they definitely tested me. If there's one thing on this planet I know, it's gymnastics. Mm-hmm. I might not know who to call for maintenance or where to go for certain forms to file, but the beauty of my sport is that the more the trends, and you need to be really up to date with it because it changes with every Olympic year. And that was, I think, the one edge I had, just being so fresh and new out of the sport myself. After some testing, I really think it was quite harmonious. I think it worked out for the better. If anything, I can only thank her for setting up such a wonderful program, mm-hmm. and I wouldn't change anything.
What's your background in gymnastics? What is it?
17 years as a gymnast, national team for 3 years, full scholarship. I had a couple NCAA records that were broken immediately upon graduation. Mm-hmm. So I'd like to think I'm slightly decorated.
So
but
you're an old gym rat is what you are.
I am. I think the world should be best spent twisting and flipping and upside
gymnasts
down.
Gymnasts never leave the gym. They're in there all the time, all year long. Yeah. It's crazy.
It is a challenging sport, not just physically but mentally. And it takes a certain species to really do the sport, and that's, I think, what made me really step up to the challenge of taking over Jaron's position.
How many girls do you have out?
36.
36 on the varsity squad? That's it, total.
Yeah, it's a safety ratio, so we have to be 40 and under.
Oh, I see. I didn't know that.
Yeah, unfortunately.
How many assistants do you have?
Three.
You have three assistants. So there's four of you for 37 kids. Mm-hmm. It's about nine kids apiece.
1-10 ratio, yeah.
It's pretty darn good, isn't it? You like that ratio?
Not so much, but that's...
You want more coaches, assistants?
No, I think more quality than quantity, but that it's a standard in the industry, so something I have to work with.
Are they testing you, Aaron?
This summer, first week of summer practice, I show up just kind of get to know the team. I haven't been announced head coach yet. I'm out on one of their summer fun runs, and three or four of the seniors kind of look over, and they're kind of running and looking back, and they're like, who's the new guy? And I don't think they meant the coach at that point in time. He's the transfer kid. No, I think, you know, they're always going to test you. I mean, Mike Uherick was here for 28 years.
Yeah.
His assistant, Ken Covold, for 25, and, you know, not so much testing me, but it's a different style. You know, a lot of the fundamentals are the same, you know, the train distance runners, and Mike Kuharik and Ken Covold were my assistants this year, which
they are.
Offered a different, you know, just kind of, I guess, coaching style and kind
of... So you have these ghosts of LT past.
A little bit, yeah.
Behind you. They're under your jurisdiction, huh?
Yeah, so, you know, after, you know, 28 years of being the head guy, now he's not necessarily calling the shots, but it worked out well. You know, I think LT is a huge place. I mean, with what they're looking at, 3,700 students this year, close to maybe 4,000 next year, and a faculty of... 250. Coming from a small Catholic school in Denver, it was a very overwhelming place. But you know, I have a pretty good history of distance running, and you know, I trained with Colin DeRook. He was a three-time Olympian out in Boulder, and a bunch of athletes, and I know the sport, kind of like Kari said, and I think they see that right away. I run with the kids every day. You know, if I'm expecting them to do 20 quarters, I will do 20 quarters with them. And
point in time when you won't be able to do that.
Yeah,
anymore.
You know. But you know, as long as I can, you know. So I think, you know, and they understand that, they see that, and I think that's right away they respect that.
Do you have a mentor coach? Do you have someone in mind that you would say, I got into coaching partly because of this person?
Probably Don Fredericks from Geneseo High School. Top of the Quad Cities.
Yeah.
He's just met him by chance actually in college. I was running for St. Ambrose at the time, and ditched a Sunday practice to go run a road race, which was a big no-no.
Yeah.
And used some fake name to won the race. And so I was introducing myself to him as Aaron Berthold. You know, we were just talking in the crowd, and then they go, Chris Trutter, who's my middle name, my mom's maiden name, long story. Yeah. But I went up there to get the award, and he's like, Chris, I thought you said your name was Aaron. And we just immediately met and hit it off. And he's like, I've done the same thing in college. And so we did a bunch of long runs together. We still... You know, probably during the cross-country season, we would talk once or twice a week, talking about coaching philosophies.
You're picking his brain.
Picking his brain, and he's picking mine.
Do you have a mentor?
I do.
A coaching mentor?
I do.
Who might it be, if you wish to say?
Well, we're not really on speaking terms anymore.
No! Wow.
Gymnastics is one of those sports that it's a love-hate relationship. And my coach of 17 years, Todd Gardner, here in the community, he's a coach at IGI, which...
It's a club
atmosphere. The man pushed me farther and harder than any person I've ever met.
Mm-hmm.
And last time we spoke was 3 years ago. But I put him on a pedestal, and every day I don't think I have anything left in me. I just remember what kind of
what
coach he was, and I go, I can do this. And
you have a mentor?
Rod Molick.
It is Rod Molick.
Lives right here in LaGrange with his family. Coaches his daughter.
Okay, then. You all have this... This individual who stands out in your experience as an athlete, or as a teacher, coach, one or the other, but you have this mentor, role model figure, correct? Have you incorporated any of them into your style? Do you think they've creeped in? Do you find yourself, catch yourself behaving like them, saying things they said, implementing policies they implemented? Are you cloning anything from Molick, from your gymnastics coach, from your cross-country mentor? Are you incorporating any of that? Are you doing it consciously or unconsciously? What do you think?
Well, when I was my first year at Driscoll, that's what the kids, the my MO was he's trying to be like a little Moloch, that type of thing, you know, getting it, being a rookie. But that's all, you know, that's all I knew. He was effective. And I don't think I was consciously trying to emulate him, but I think naturally, whatever, when you have a role model or a coach that you know, you look up to, I think you're going to have those things that are going to come out, as long as it's your own persona.
Are those things working?
Oh, yeah.
Are the Moloch influenced things, are they're working?
They've been working for my tenure, as long as I've been teaching.
Now, we could patch it up with your buddy here of 7 years.
He's probably watching,
you
yes.
Think he's watching? Does he live in this area?
He does. Okay. I'll be getting a phone call
Okay,
later.
Let's patch it up. Right? Okay. Is there anything you're doing that you would
yes.
say is a...
Yeah,
okay.
Absolutely.
You are modeling something he taught you.
Yes, on a daily basis.
Yeah, and it's working.
It is.
See what I mean? Yeah?
I would say the same thing. Yeah,
it's working.
Yeah.
This mentor you're imitating or borrowing, whatever you want to call it, emulating, I think is a better word. You are emulating what you were taught, and it is working. Yeah. This is where we find transition between generations.
It's like a gleaning.
Yeah. Yeah. I think as coaches, I mean, I'm going to speak for these guys, but you borrow things from hundreds of different people.
But it's definitely a minority of your repertoire. It's not your entire philosophy or approach.
No.
It's an aspect of it.
I think it's what helps you when you first start. I mean, you always have it with you, but then as you get older and you start researching and trying to become a better teacher, a better coach.
Okay. Tell me then, what are you doing for your athletes today that coach would have never done for their athletes?
Smile.
Did you hear that? Buster boy. Did you hear that? He smile.
Definitely.
Openness. Engaging.
Yes.
Engaging approach. Yeah, it might certainly in my generation there are plenty of coaches who beratement was their style and distance was plenty of distance. They were definitely on a pedestal. But what you're not doing that he did is you're making an attempt to be more engaging of kids. Yeah. Is that it? What are you doing? What are you doing, Tim, that your role model mentor did not do?
You hit it on the head where I think at that time, at least when I was playing, you know, as the family started to, you know, you're getting more needs in the players than there was,
noticed,
I think, back then.
Yeah,
yes, I have. So I think you have that gray area where I know I can address my team and treat my team a certain way, but there's particular ways I have to coach individual kids and know what buttons to push there. I think that was, which you could have, back when I was playing, it was more of a broad stroke.
Right, it was a general approach and it worked pretty well and it was efficient enough, but now you find yourself individualized.
Right.
Yeah. I don't know, with Don Fredericks, there's a lot of similarities with the two of us, but I wouldn't say there's one thing that I'm definitely...
What are you doing that he would never do?
Running with your kids?
He runs with
his kids. I mean, he's relatively. I mean, I would still. He's probably. Oh, he's got. He's getting to be 40. He's probably 50, 49, 50. Mm-hmm. Probably screw up his age here. but now he still runs with his kids. You know, not the same. You know, he'll tell you the same thing. I'm not with my front kids anymore. But he still runs with his kids, and I'm probably doing maybe some differences as far as. Like the training philosophies and longer runs, I think a big believer.
There's a lot more science in cross country than one might think.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah. Okay, when you evaluate your runners, objectively, as being objective as possible, do you see any similarities between you as a runner in the old days, in your career as a runner, and them, or are they? Are you looking at a different animal altogether? Do you see yourself in the kids you're coaching?
I do. I see. I don't with the masses, no, but with the, you know, a lot of our varsity athletes or the some of the freshmen that are coming in, I see. I mean, I can see myself. It's like looking at, you know, at a mirror. You know, some of these kids on their own, they're getting up in the morning. They want to put in extra miles. Mm-hmm. You know, they're doing maybe a 4 mile shakeout run. Before school, on their own, didn't even ask them to do it, and that was
me. That was you.
That was me in high school.
Passion.
Yeah, just, I mean, didn't have a good meet. I'm out in the country. Dad's taking me home for the meet, dropped me off here. I'm going to run a few miles extra because didn't have a good meet. But, no, there's a kind of a crazy thing with distance runners and just kind of the pressure you put on yourself. And, I mean, I think it's, you know, so you say the same with
gymnasts. Do you have one girl's gymnast who reminds you of yourself?
Ironically, Alyssa Molek.
She does remind you of you.
When she gets on the competition floor, she just sparkles. And I just remember how I felt, you know, I get up on that balance beam and I just turn on a bit of a competitor. So, yeah, she's...
She reminds you of yourself.
Very much so.
This is good. This is good because these are the kids. And before I ask you, Tim, if that's the case, if you have a player or players who you see a bit of yourself in them, these are the kids that sustain teachers, that keep teachers and coaches teaching and coaching. If you didn't see yourself in the kids, let's say you're in for a bad situation, you're in for a bad experience. You see these kids, it reminds you of you?
Yeah, well, the best thing that happened to me was when I went to Driscoll, so I played football at a small private high school, so I was the big fish in a little pond, and then I went to play at Southern Illinois, played way over my head. You know, everybody said, it was one of those things where everybody said, you know, I wouldn't be able to make it there, which I did, but, you know, I went from having that role of knowing what it was like to be the guy to being the guy in the bench, being the guy that was hurt, being the guy that was just on special teams. So I think every role that I've been through every role that every one of my kids in the football field could see.
You're the universal kid.
You got it. I know what the kid that doesn't play, you know, the kid
this
that's hurt.
This, this is good.
So I know to empathize with all of them. I think that's why I went through that 4 years of, because it was tough, but I know why I went through it, because of what I'm doing now.
There is this theory that some of the best coaches are coaches who were not star players. And the other theory is, conversely, the stars never make good coaches. It's like in literature, there's school of thought that supports Shakespeare as the true author of the plays and no one, and not Edward de Vere or anyone else. And one of the professors on this tape that we used to use at school said, it is never the rich kids who write the plays. It's never the stars who wind up the good coaches. It's never them. They are too natural. They didn't know how to teach it. They just felt it. They did it. So there, you see the universality of yourself in some of these kids.
Oh, yeah.
Because you were there. You sat on the bench. You were injured. You were just special teams, but you were the big guy in high school.
Right.
But it's good. I think that's going to make you a better coach, really. Hey, we have to do it again. We have to take a 2-minute break for federal regulation reasons because public service announcements are required of us. And they're very tasteful and palatable. You'll learn something and enjoy it, so watch it. But don't forget that we're back here waiting for you. Channel 99 or 16, depending on where you live. This is the Inside Corner. We'll be right here. Please come back.
~1200 American youth run away from their homes every day. The National Runaway Switchboard is here to help. 1-800-RUNAWAY. If you are a runaway, thinking about running away from home, or a parent or guardian concerned about issues facing your child, call us 24 hours a day. 1-800-RUNAWAY. In times of crisis, hope is just a phone call away. 1-800-RUNAWAY.
How far would you go to help someone? Would you go to the end of your driveway? Would you cross a street? Would you cross an ocean? Would you go if you could use your knowledge to teach someone? And in the process, maybe learn something yourself. Life is calling. How far will you go? Peace Corps.
I just wanted to eat like a normal human being, you know? Just something I could hold down without the horrible pain.
Crohn's disease and ulcerative colitis are diseases that attack the digestive system.
A feeding tube's not my idea of a good meal.
At the Crohn's and Colitis Foundation of America, we're excited about the latest research.
Then there was this new drug.
Thousands of people are being treated with new drug therapies.
Doc said it doesn't work for everyone, but I got lucky.
CCFA provides a lifeline of research, education, and support.
Now I'm taking food the old-fashioned way. I'm eating it.
Sure, my neighbors Gene and Louise, they may be superheroes with superpowers, but that doesn't make them so super at saving energy and money.
Honey!
I may not be able to harness the power of the elements, but I save significant cash and help the environment with appliances, electronics, and windows featuring the Energy Star label. So discover your own energy-saving superpowers. Go to ase.org/consumers.
Mom, Dad's making fondue again.
Thank you for coming back. Once again, I'm Terry Sullivan. This is the Insight Corner. We are discussing teachers and coaches, the next generation. Given the hundreds and hundreds, perhaps thousands, I'm for sure thousands of early retirements that have taken place in Illinois, is the next generation stepping up? I have with me Tim Radke, Dean of Students and Head Football Coach at Nazareth Academy. One, Kari Karubus, English teacher and Head Girls Gymnastics Coach at Lyons Township High School. And Aaron Berthold, Business Education Teacher and Boys Cross Country Coach at LT. And we're tossing this around. What do they feel the expectations are on themselves? And how do they see themselves? What's their profile? And what are their approaches? And questions like... the single most important value or lesson that you think sports should teach? This is a crucial question. The whole program could be about this. What's the life lesson your guys, your girls are supposed to extract from the experience that they have with you? This is crucial. What is it they're going to take away from having been with you? Cross country for 4 years, gymnastics and all the time it takes, football and all the pain and misery. What are they going to take out of it? What is it that you want them to take away? And is it at all similar to the last coach who spent 30 years trying to do that very thing? Tell me, what are they supposed to walk away with? A lesson in what?
That you're a lifelong runner and a lifelong learner. It never stops. I want my kids coming back, even if they were mediocre in high school. I just ran my first Chicago Marathon. I ran my fifth, Turkey Trot 5K, mm-hmm. that they're not stopping in 4 years. It's important to me. I've had kids already in 5 years of coaching at Regis come back, and they're still running. And
they're lifelong runners, which is a benefit, health benefit, recreational benefit, and they're lifelong learners, as exhibited by their struggle to learn running. And learning themselves as runners.
Right. I mean, it doesn't matter what the subject is.
Okay. So it's an introspective benefit for them. They get to know themselves is what you're saying. Am I right here?
Exactly.
All right. What are they going to take away from being on the beam and falling in public and getting hurt?
Well,
breaking their knees and their
yes,
ankles?
Yes. Gymnastics is one of those sports that when you do hit the ground, it's not pleasant getting back up. If anything, I want them to know their limits and know that they're more than... what's in front of them, that they're farther, and then realize that they're a lot stronger, more resilient, and more capable of more.
You want them to know their limitations.
And exceed them.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
And exceed them and surpass them and knock down those barriers.
How could they possibly have any plans in life if they didn't know what they weren't good at?
True.
And everyone's afraid to approach them with that topic. Well, look, I know you're great at this and you're great at this, but what do you think you're limited at? And let's attack that. No one ever asks them that. What are your limitations?
Well, and with gymnastics, there are four events. So you might have maybe upper body strength and can swing wonderful bars, but maybe not enough lower body strength and you can't run down the vault runway. And so it challenges you from head to toe, mentally and physically and emotionally. So I think it's really a metaphor for the rest of your life. If you can attack a day in the gym, sustain it for 4 years, transfer that knowledge, you're okay.
Yeah. The struggle of the athlete is a metaphor for life. If he can face his limitations and overcome them, then he can do the same thing working for IBM when he didn't get the promotion he expected. He can plug through that and get it the next time or start his own company. All right, so it's the idea of knowing yourself and knowing your limitations, very similar answers. What are they going to take away from Tim Radke at Nazareth?
Two main things. When you're successful, I try to teach the young men I coach to be humble and modest and always trying to give something back. So when they meet that success in life, they don't get all full of themselves or just think it's about them. And then on the other hand, when you hit the bottom, And when you hit that adversity, that you stay poised, you know, and then you learn how to work through it. Become a leader during the times when things aren't going your way. Yeah. You know, that down the road when they're with their families and they go through a tragedy.
Right.
That they'll stand up to it and
control,
take a leadership role.
Control and perspective.
Right.
Yeah. These are excellent lessons. They're all very similar. It's all about you against, it's all about them against themselves, and what you can teach them is how to win that, them against themselves. These are good answers, encouraging answers. I think you're going to pass the muster. I think you'll be able to step up and take the place of Rod Molek and Jaron Williams and Mike Kuharik and all these other legendary people that have been around these towns. Names you wouldn't even know. Ali Stenger. You don't know Ali Stenger from anybody. You know, there's the Stenger medal, but you don't know anything about that. But he, all these legendary coaches. And I think you're going to be able to do this. But tell me, are you spending more time doing social work? What percentage of your time coaching is doing social work? By that I mean discipline and counseling. What percentage of your time? Discipline and counseling, what percentage?
I don't think, okay, I think that it depends the day, it depends what's going on. It's part of the package. You know, you are going to get an athlete to produce, and it's going to take whatever it takes, whether it's, you know, skilling and drilling, if it's running, if it's working out, or if it's chatting with them and being there for them. And it's the kid, it's the day, it's just part of it.
Yeah.
And today's day and age brings us a more needy kid, and any good coach that wants a successful program will be that social worker.
Mm-hmm. You have to be. And it's probably the better part of the job. It's the better opportunity. Because if you're going to be at the if a kid's going to come to you and reveal to you that he's at the crossroads of a decision, important decision in his life, isn't that where you want to be? Isn't that what you get into the business for? Because no, you know what? I'll tell you the truth. No one's going to know, Aaron, if you won the state championship 20 years from now. They won't know who the heck you are 20 years from now. But some kid someplace is going to remember when Aaron said to you, when Coach Berthold said, hey, kid, this is what life really is about. The kid will remember that. But the crowd won't remember who the coach was when they won the state championship.
That's what I
stress.
Except
if you're Joe Newton and you win it every year, then they're going to remember your name.
You don't want you don't want the state title to be the pinnacle of your life.
Yeah.
You want to use it to help you reach bigger and better things with your family and professional life.
Yeah.
That was the one thing I was worried about.
Which is, brings me to a good question. Would you rather win the state championship or have five players on college scholarship? Got your choice. You can win, the devil comes to you and says, I'll tell you what, I'll make you a deal. You're going to win the state championship, but you're not going to have anybody go to college and play this sport. But you'll win the state championship. Or I'll provide for you five kids on your club that will win college scholarships, but you're not winning the state championship. Which are you going to take? The state championship or the college scholarships?
Are they getting the scholarships for athletics for their sport?
Yes, for your sport.
I mean, in cross country, I mean, if you have five guys, you're going to get scholarships in 1 year, you're going to win the state.
I understand. I understand, yeah. They're going to be five, one, two, three, four, and five finishers. I understand that. Hypothetically. Place of value.
If they get a chance or an opportunity to experience the sport another 4 years, and they're not going to if we win the state championship, I would rather not win the state championship than have five individuals get to experience what a lot of us here have got to experience.
Same
way?
Sorry, I'm going state title. Not for me.
Tell me why.
Because I'm going to have... And then this is football. You have 50-plus kids on varsity, maybe 60. If I have five kids that are going to go on to play at the next level, that's great. But I'm going to have, if I'm winning a state title, you're going to have 60 kids that are going to live an experience that's going to go a lifetime with that medal.
Yeah.
It's, you know, to where, you know, again, it's hypothetical because not, you know, I don't have to say if there was five kids that I had that.
So what you're saying, you're going to have 60 kids share a rare experience.
Absolutely.
That might boost their self-concept or who knows what, teach them that they can do it again some other walk of life.
Right.
Good point. As long as you look at it that way.
Right. Oh, yeah. That's
Instead of saying, yeah, I'd rather have the trophy than the...
Right, yeah, exactly.
this is a good point.
It's about all those kids.
Spoken like a true teacher. This is good. Are you experiencing any drain on your emotional energy lately?
your head coaches. There's the paperwork. There's the coordination of a staff. There's the overseeing of all of the kids in the program, not just the varsity level. There are the parents who come to you when Johnny and Jane aren't playing enough. Because, you know, we had him at that camp at Michigan, and they said that he was Big Ten caliber, and he's sitting on the bench with you, all of that. Plus, if you have forgotten, our three participants tonight are just a small example that you are forgetting that head coaches are also teaching five classes. This is the dean of students, attendance and discipline all day long. And then five classes of English and five classes of business education. You think this is a hobby? Then, when they spend all that emotional energy, they have to go out on the practice field and on the contest field and spend even more. And the kids out there are expecting them to give equal effort in regard to their displayed investment in today's game or practice. What are you doing? Are you feel drained all of a sudden now? I mean, you're making a whole lot more money than you were at Regis Jesuit. Do you feel?
No,
I feel drained.
Yeah, I'm running cross country season with 12 days of new teacher orientation and 2 day practice.
12 days of new teacher orientation.
12 days, 2 days of 2 day practices.
And you wonder why there are unions. 12 days of teacher orientation.
So yeah, my first month and a half, or really probably first. I mean, through I got the state meeting in November. Yeah, I mean, coming back from practice at 6 o'clock, showering and realizing I have 3 hours of prep to do
for the next day's class.
To get through one more day.
Did you get a big raise when you came here to LTTV?
Yeah, the money was a little bit better.
Yeah, it was better, wasn't it? Yeah. Well, you're earning every penny of it, buddy, aren't you?
Yeah.
You are. What are you doing? What do you do to distract yourself so you don't get fatigued to the level where you can't do it the next day? What are you doing?
I run.
Do you?
Yeah.
Well, it can, you know, ironically, it can be rejuvenating.
Yeah.
It increases your depth of energy.
No, I'm.
So that's what you do. That's your therapy.
It's my therapy.
What do you do?
I have a 2.5-year-old boy now.
Yeah.
So he's
a complete distraction.
I'm trying to get in a new routine now. Being my commute is a lot longer now because I used to work out every morning before school. And that's, ironically, that's when I start Tuesday again. I just have to get up at 4:30.
Get the routine. No. 4:30.
Well, it's either that or work out at 10 o'clock at night. You know, when you have a kid now, it's changes.
You find yourself dealing with the same 10% of the disciplinary problems every day? It's the same 10% of the student body or 5% of the student body? Is it the same kids over and over again?
You know, I'm being new. I'm just getting to know, you know,
who they
territory.
Are. Yeah, who they are, yeah.
A little bit.
It's that 5% or 10%.
But you're
yeah. Yeah. Okay. I'm glad you've got something going in terms of rejuvenation so you can face this stuff that you spend so much emotional energy on. What about political realities? Parents, for instance. Does that compromise your personal ethics and the fact that you have to cajole them and kind of kowtow to them and play the game, do the dance? Are there any political pressures? Maybe it's not in the parental public relations department. Maybe it's somewhere else. Maybe it's pleasing a boss. Or are there certain political realities that you're experiencing?
At LT? Isn't it the friendliest high school in the nation?
Yes, of course.
No, there's politics everywhere. Yeah. I mean, whether you're at, you know, Regis Jesuit in Denver or LT, I mean, especially being new, you kind of learn the game, but
you learn how to cope.
Yeah, you know, you deal with. I mean, you're talking about that 5-10% of kids. Yeah. You have the 5-10% of parents, maybe more in football, that you have to deal with, and you just
take my word. Take my advice on something. Never, ever, ever enter into discussion with parents about playing time. Never. As soon as they bring it up, say, "I don't talk about that." If you want to talk about the treatment of your kid, fine. I'm not going to talk to you about why he's not playing. Just don't do that. And don't compare. Don't let them compare kids to each other. My kid did this, and you gave so-and-so over here this. Don't ever enter into that discussion. They have no right to that. They have no right to talk about playing time. Their membership on the team is a privilege.
See, I'd rather them vent with me than at the dinner table with the kid, with my athlete. I'd rather have them come to me about the playing time thing, and I can do the best I can, even though I know you're saying they probably won't be happy with whatever answer.
No, they're not.
But you know what, though? Then they're not around the dinner table, because that's what I tell my parents. At least if you have a problem, come talk to me, because I don't want them around the dinner table.
You think there are parents who would take their kids a task for not playing enough?
Or no, they would attack me or the team, which would poison the whole type of atmosphere, the whole team, family, brotherhood you're trying to put together.
So you talk about social work, this is the type of thing you have to be worried about in 2006. Who does not have the right to evaluate you? Let's go down a checklist. Do the kids have the right to evaluate you? They're the constituents. Do they have the right to evaluate
Absolutely, in my opinion. Yeah. Hmm?
Does LT or Nazareth make you pass out evaluation sheets to kids? Is there any written copy, hard copy from kids back to your supervisor about you during the year? At LT there is.
Not really, not for me, no.
Okay, look out for this. It's a new form of leverage. Do parents have the right to evaluate you in terms of your coaching expertise? You got to have a solid answer on this. They'll eat you alive.
Do they have a right to, or do they?
Do they have a right to evaluate you on why Joe Smith is the number one runner in today's meet and not Larry Jones? Do they have a right to evaluate you on that? Do they have the right to say who the quarterback should be?
No, because they don't.
So in that column,
we don't go into their office or their workplace, and
that's right. And you're not a doctor, a lawyer, or a carpenter.
I
don't go to their joint.
I begin to tell them how to handle a trial.
Okay, you got to build your script. Yeah, you got to have a script. They have no right to that. They do have a right to come to you and say, "Hey, this is what you said about my son to him, and I object to that, and I think you're wrong. And what? Tell me more about it." They have every right to do that, but they don't have a right to come to you and say, "Sam should be the quarterback."
Sure. Right. I agree.
I can't tell you how many times this year I've said, we're just going to have to agree to disagree.
Yeah.
And, there's always the best interest of team over individual goals, and there's always safety. Yeah. And,
Yeah, all that. You're responsible for all these
things.
Those things
are,
whether you realize that or not.
All of my factors when making a decision.
It's such a complex occupation. Coaching is so complex that, it can drown you in the long run. Hey. Don't get drowned, all right? Mm. Tim,
thanks, Terry.
Thanks for coming over. Tim Racki from Nazareth, Kari Karubus, gymnastics at LT, and Aaron Berthold. It's good to have you all, and I feel confident. If I had more children, and I don't think I am, but if I had more children, I'd be glad to give them over to you, and you could transform them for me. I want to thank Tom Sklarski, my director, and Mike May, my producer. This is Terry Sullivan. This has been The Inside Corner. I'll be home in just a few minutes, Dolly, so leave the door open, okay? See you again.